Please explain. Really? Are you sure about that? Are you sure?
So, as most people know, I have an autism spectrum disorder. I was originally diagnosed with Asperger's syndrome, but that term is no longer used anymore. Today's video, I wanted to share my diagnosis story. You know, what led up to me being referred to getting a diagnosis and how I actually got the diagnosis itself. So I hope you enjoy. So let's start from the beginning. When I was around one or two, I was showing clear signs of OCD. I was having severe meltdowns that could last for hours and hours and hours and hours. And I couldn't explain to my parents why I was so upset. I was an extremely angry child.
Not show people.
I was also having major issues with change. Any sign of change to my routine or any spontaneous events really triggered me. I apparently showed lack of empathy or understanding of emotions. I couldn't express my own emotions and I didn't know what to do with other people's emotions. I was obsessed with being in control.
Stay there!
Over there, because it's the show on me. And don't get that brush, it's to make us all good.
Now you beat me up, I won still.
Shift up, lad.
So you won then, did you?
And having order to everything.
I really don't want it to do that because it looks weird.
Well,
I loved repetitive behaviours. You know, the same thing over and over and over again. And I was extremely honest.
What about you, Darcy? What did he get you? What you wanted?
Basically, I was showing weird behaviours that my parents just couldn't deal with and also thought needs to be looked at, obviously. So, on the 31st of May 2006, my parents had had enough and they took me to the doctors to get me referred to CAMHS, which is Child and Adolescent Mental Health Service, I think. I was referred. And my parents did a questionnaire just to explain my behaviour, which is this. Basically, my parents explained that I have behavioural problems, they're intermittent, the behaviour is manifested as anger and severe irritation. We think it may be a genetical condition because she has a need for order, control and a natural lack of empathy. We're unsure of the best way to deal with the tantrum. She's 8 now. We would have expected them to have finished, but they haven't. And CAMHS came back and said that I just had anger management issues and that my parents had raised me wrong and that they needed parenting classes. So that was that. So my parents tried to control my behaviour, they tried to deal with it and manage my anger, but they couldn't. And 2 years later, on the 21st of September 2009, they went back to the doctors and had me referred to a paediatrician who then referred me to CAMHS. I don't know whether it was this doctor or the paediatrician, but one of them had a child who was on the autistic spectrum and they heard all about my behaviour and they saw me and they were like, I recognise that, that's what my child has. And my parents described that as being very lucky because no one was kind of taking this seriously and everyone was saying that it was behavioural problems, like anger issues. And this doctor recognised it immediately. So finally, I was referred to CAMHS and I was put on the waiting list, which I was on for a year. So, yeah. That was long. A year later, on the 22nd of January 2010, I had my first CAMHS appointment and At this point in time, I think my parents were pushing for, obviously, OCD, but they were also pushing for borderline personality disorder, which I will display the characteristics on the screen. It's very similar to autism slash Asperger's at the time, and unfortunately a lot of people are misdiagnosed as having BPD when actually they have an autism spectrum condition. But this is what my parents had suspected that I have. So the process began, and I had several sessions at CAMHS, several appointments, and it was finally concluded that I probably have ASD. And so that started the process of getting tested for ASD. So I did two questionnaires. I did an autism screener questionnaire that looks for autism, and I did an autism spectrum screening questionnaire that looks for autism spectrum disorder. These are the questionnaires. The questionnaire that looked at autism specifically, I scored low on, so that ruled out that I had just autism. Then we did the autism spectrum screening questionnaire, and I scored high on this questionnaire, which meant that I potentially have autism spectrum disorder. Then I also did a mind blindness test. Basically, mind blindness is just the inability to develop an awareness of what is in the mind of another human, so not being able to put yourselves in other people's shoes. It's also a lack of empathy and being completely unaware of the impact your behaviour may be having on others. And there are many different tests that can determine this, such as the famous Sally Ann test. I didn't do this test, I don't think. I had to pretend that I was going to be jumping out at passerbys on the streets, and basically they looked at whether I could determine who the right people to jump out at is. So for example, a blind man definitely won't jump out at them, or your sister. Yes, I will definitely jump out at her. So you get the gist of it. So let's see what I kind of put. Two teenage girls, yes, definitely jump out at them. Boy with a small dog, I'm not too sure, potentially. The local traffic warden, yeah, I'll jump out at them. The traffic warden. An elderly nun, not too sure about that one, potentially. So yeah, that was that. On the 23rd of November 2010, I had a few anger management sessions where I was learning to control my anger, and it was a way for my parents to understand how to control my anger outbursts and my meltdowns. My parents also took a developmental history assessment, so that's looking at my development, my family history, which is like 6 pages long. So then it gets to the 5th of May 2011. I had an educational psychologist come into my school without my knowledge and watch me in classes. Now, my experience, I remember this random woman came into our classroom and the teacher like introduced her and said that she's just gonna watch us. She's monitoring my teacher, and all I could think about was, I need to impress her. I need to show that I'm the best in the class. I kind of, looking back at that, feel like that wasn't a good representation of me, even though the teachers afterwards said that the way I behaved was a good representation. But I just know that I was trying to impress even more than I normally do. I mean, in the end, they concluded that I had very well-developed social skills, but that I did have Asperger's syndrome from what they could see. They watched me in one classroom setting, and they also watched me in my drama class. And then this was her conclusion, Asperger's. So that was the educational psychologist school observation. Then on the 17th of May, I had an ADOS test, which is the Autism Diagnostic Observations Schedule, and it is the typical test that someone who may potentially have autism spectrum disorder takes. So basically, during this test, I had to answer questions on friendships, general questions, emotions, and then I would also do different activities. And this was all in a room which had a one-way mirror, and if I'm correct, my parents were behind the mirror, my clinician was behind the mirror, the psychiatrist, I think some people from school. I remember going into this room and seeing the mirror and thinking, why the hell is there a mirror in this room? And automatically knowing, everyone's watching me behind that, aren't they? Like, this is ridiculous. These are the activities that I remember personally, which was that there was like a template and there were shapes, like cut out shapes, and I had to put the right shapes in the holes. I think the examiner gave me a pen and asked me to pretend that it was something else or describe what it could be. I also remember that there was this book and it was just a picture book. There was different images on each page, obviously. And I had to describe to the examiner what was going on in the story. But yeah, that's what I remember of my experience. And these are the rest of the activities that I apparently did, which was, I was given a load of toys and I had to make up a story with any toys of my choosing. And then eventually the examiner would try and join in and see if I resist. And then there was also a bag full of toys. I had to pick out 5 random objects or items from that bag and also make up a story. I had to tell the examiner how to brush their teeth with an imaginary toothbrush. So like, yeah, you get me. Yes, there'd be like a picture of something and I would have to describe what's going on in the picture. Yeah, I think that's everything. And then the summary was that I have the score of autism spectrum disorder. So that was that. And then on the 24th of May 2011, I then had my final assessment, which was a speech and language assessment. And yeah, they concluded ASD. So on the 20th of June 2011, I was finally given the letter that confirmed my diagnosis. Now, after all of this, we already knew that I had it. So I was technically diagnosed at around like 10 or 11, but the actual letter came through when I was 12. So the final process, I think, was there's this like group session called This Is Me, where other patients with ASD go and we just learn about what it is that we have. And I didn't want to go. I think I just did like a one-to-one with my clinician. So I voluntarily decided to make a presentation on what I'd learnt and present it to my social worker. I don't have the actual presentation now, but I do have a printout of each slide. So we're gonna go through it and I can see on the screen that this is going to be back to front. So I am just going to flip the camera when editing. So we're just gonna go through it. This is the first slide. So it says here, in my opinion, Asperger's is a lifelong condition. It's not an opinion, that is fact. People with Asperger's struggle with the following 3 things. They struggle to explain or say what they feel out loud because they are very good at writing it down. We can get fixed on something and get distracted, so nothing else is going on but what we are fixed on. This means we don't listen to others talking when we are fixed. Asperger's people are very intelligent, love being creative. We also like taking risks and going on big rides. Being very generalistic, even though this is majoritively just my experience. We hate being touched or hugged by someone. It feels as though we are being crushed by something and we can get uncomfortable. Although we find it okay to hug other people, but it's on our terms. I struggle to read something and understand it. I have to read it over and over again until I get it. Literally, relating to this sentence, I'm literally just going to show you. 5 minutes ago, I struggle to read something and understand it. Like a mind blank. This might be because of surroundings, noise elsewhere that can be distracting me, but sometimes I'm in a quiet room and it still has the same effect. It can make me scared for tests or exams because I know I will struggle. Social interaction. This is when people with Asperger's struggle to interact with others. They find it hard to join in or make friends with people. Usually they like to be on their own. I love it when I know that the day is going to be what I want, so I can do whatever I want. If my order of the day is switched around or changed, I will get depressed. I don't like it when I'm in a loud room. I don't like it when there's too much light or when people talk too much. It makes me stressed or angry, or as we would call it, creeping up on us. People with AS have good memory, good ideas. People can normally tell what each other are thinking by the tone of voice and body language, but people with AS find it difficult to see this, and so we think different things, which can make us unhappy and confused. Then I have this slide. What I need to do. I need to tell people how I feel and why. I need to give good body language to people when they are talking to me. I should ask people what is happening in the day so I can put together an order of how it will work that day without things messing it up. And then the final slide was what mum and dad should do. You need to tell me what's happening in the day. You need to get my full attention by making sure that I'm agreeing with you to stop what I'm fixed at. Then maybe make me repeat what you say so I know what you're telling me, because I usually wouldn't listen to them, or I'm in my own world. You need to ask me how I feel when I'm depressed or angry, and maybe make me a timetable for me to put in my order of the week and your order so we both know what is happening without it ruining my day. That was my little presentation. So that was my long and painful diagnosis process at CAMHS. But luckily, I was able to be diagnosed, and unfortunately, a lot of people out there don't get that diagnosis, or it takes a lot longer, or they just don't have the opportunity, or they're on waiting lists. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed my video again, and I will see you with my next one very soon, because I have a lot of ideas. Thanks for watching.